Hello, welcome yet again to the second part of the lecture which we are doing. Now, I am Ashwin Joglekar, I am from Resonance PCCP Division, and we were discussing the chapter, the making of the regional cultures, and the second part of the chapter is talking about the tradition of miniatures and painting for patrons. That is, the patrons, the one who were giving this art form a boost or were protecting the art forms in India which were prevalent at that time. ओके सो लेट अस स्टार्ट विद द ट्रेडिशन ऑफ मिनिएचर्स फॉर्म ऑफ पेंटिंग है ये ठीक है जिसके बारे में हम बात करेंगे अभी अब पेंटिंग फॉर पेट्रंस दैट इज अनदर ट्रेडिशन दैट डेवलप्ड इन डिफरेंट वेज वाज दैट ऑफ मिनिएचर पेंटिंग नाउ मिनिएचर्स एज देयर वेरी नेम सजेस्ट आर स्मॉल साइज पेंटिंग्स मिनिएचर है ठीक है तो मिनिएचर का मतलब स्मॉल साइज पेंटिंग है दे आर नॉट दैट लार्ज पेंटिंग्स जनरली डन इन वॉटर और कलर basically on cloth or paper. The earliest miniatures were on palm leaves or wood. Some of the most beautiful of these found in Western India were used to illustrate the Jain text. The Mughal emperors also Akbar, Jahangir and Shah Jahan patronized highly skilled painters who primarily illustrated manuscripts containing historical accounts and data and poetry. These were generally painted in brilliant colors and portrayed court scenes, scenes of battle or hunting and other aspects of social life of that period. They were often exchanged as gifts and were viewed only by an exclusive few, the emperor and his close associates. So these paintings were not on display for everyone. Now, with the decline of the Mughal Empire, many painters started moving out because now the court itself could not pay them much, moved out to the courts of the emerging regional states. And as a result, Mughal artistic taste influenced the regional courts of the Deccan and the Rajput courts of Rajasthan. At the same time, they retained and developed their distinctive characteristics. So, move bhi huye dusri jagahon pe, but apni jo distinctive characteristics hai, usko bhi unhone waise hi rakha. Aur plus, jahan jis region mein gaye, wahan ki characteristics ko bhi adopt karke ek naya art form kind of develop karne ki koshish kari. So, portraits of rulers and court scenes came to be painted following the Mughal example. Besides themes from mythology and poetry depicted at centers such as Mewar, Jodhpur, Bundi, Kota and Kishangarh. Another region that attracted was the Himalayan foothills, that is the Kangra form of painting. Another region that attracted miniature painting was the Himalayan foothills around the modern day state of Himachal Pradesh. And by the late 17th century, this region had developed a bold and intense style of painting. Miniature painting called Basholi or Basoholi. The most popular text to be painted here was Bhanu Datta's Rasa Manjari or Nadir Shah's which was being painted here or depicted here. Now Nadir Shah's invasion and the conquest of Delhi in 1739 resulted in the migration of Mughal artists to these regions, to the hills to escape the uncertainties of the plains. Here they found ready patterns which led to the founding of the Kangra school of painting. By the mid 18th century, the Kangra artists developed a style which breathed a new spirit into the miniature form of painting. The source of inspiration came was the Vaishnavite traditions which were there, right? Soft colors including cool blues and greens were used and a lyrical treatment of themes distinguished Kangra paintings. Case study. That is Bengal, the growth of regional languages. Bengal and the growth of regional languages. Now, as we saw at the outset, we often tend to identify regions in terms of the language. So, generally, hum kisi bhi region ko jab identify karte, to hum uski language se usko identify karte. Ki wahan pe kaun si bhasha boli jati hai? By the people. Language spoken by the people. So, we assume that people in Bengal always spoke Bengali. Right? However, what is interesting is that while Bengali is now recognized as a language there, derived from Sanskrit, early Sanskrit texts, that is mid first millennium BC, suggest that the people of Bengal did not speak Sanskritic languages. Then how did they start or develop the new language emerge? That is from the 4th and 3rd centuries BC, commercial ties began to develop between Bengal and Magadha, South Bihar, which may have led to the growing influence of Sanskrit onto the Bengali people as well or onto the region of Bengal. During the 4th century, the Gupta rulers established political control over North Bengal and began to settle Brahmins in this area. Thus, the linguistic, that is the language related, and cultural influence from the mid Ganga Valley became stronger in this region of Bengal. In the 7th century, the Chinese traveler Zhang observed that language related to Sanskrit were in use all over Bengal. So, from the 8th century, Bengal became the center of a regional kingdom under the Palas that we have studied in the second chapter, that is, right? There was a tripartite struggle. Now, between the 14th and 16th century, Bengal was again ruled by sultans who were independent of the rulers in Delhi. In 1586, when Akbar conquered Bengal and formed the nucleus of the Bengal Suba, that is a regional kingdom. While Persian was the language of the administration, Bengali developed as a regional language at that time. In fact, by 15th century, the Bengali group of dialects came to be united by a common literary language based on the spoken language of the western part of the region, which is now known as West Bengal. So, Western Bengal, yeah, West Bengal, में जो languages बोली जाती थी, that is Bengali group of dialects came to be united. तो उन्होंने अपने आप को unite करके एक common literary language जो सब बोल सके उस रीजन में वो डेवलप करी, ठीक है. एंड अगेन बेस्ड ऑन द स्पोकन लैंग्वेज जो वेस्टर्न पार्ट जो है बेसिकली बंगाल का, उसने उसको डोमिनेट कर. दस ऑल्दो बंगाली इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम संस्कृत, इट पास थ्रू सेवरल स्टेजेस ऑफ एवोल्यूशन. तो संस्कृत से डिराइव भी हुई है, बट उसने सेवरल स्टेजेस ऑफ एवोल्यूशन को पास करा, ठीक है, सो दैट वो आज जो प्रेजेंट फॉर्म में है उसमें डेवलप हो पाई. ऑल्सो वाइड रेंज ऑफ नॉन सांस्कृतिक वर्ड्स डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम वाइड वेराइटी ऑफ सोर्सेज इंक्लूडिंग ट्राइबल लैंग्वेजेस, वहां की पर्शियन लैंग्वेजेस, यूरोपियन लैंग्वेजेस हैव बिकम पार्ट ऑफ मॉडर्न बंगाली. तो मॉडर्न बंगाली में बाकी ऐसी चीजें भी इंक्लूडेड है, दैट इज विच आर नॉट द वर्ड्स आर नॉट फ्रॉम संस्कृत, बट देयर ओरिजिन प्रॉब्ली कैन बी ट्रेस फ्रॉम द ट्राइबल लैंग्वेजेस और द पर्शियन और द यूरोपियन लैंग्वेजेस. नाउ अर्ली बंगाली लिटरेचर में बी डिवाइडेड इंटू टू कैटेगरीज, दैट इज वन इज इंडेप्टेड टू संस्कृत ऑब्वियसली एंड अदर इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ इट. सो दो कैटेगरीज में हमने डिवाइड कर दिया इसको, अर्ली जो बंगाली लिटरेचर, एक तो कंप्लीटली जो संस्कृत किसे उसको से डिराइव हुआ है, और एक दूसरा जो संस्कृत से बिल्कुल अलग है एक तरह से, इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ इट. द रेस्ट इंक्लूड्स ट्रांसलेशन ऑफ द संस्कृत एपिक्स, मंगल काव्यस, लिटरली ऑस्पिशियस पोएम्स डीलिंग विद लोकल डेटीज, एंड भक्ति लिटरेचर सच एज द बायोग्राफीज ऑफ चैतन्य देवा, द लीडर ऑफ द वैष्णव भक्ति मूवमेंट इन बंगाल रीजन. द सेकेंड इंक्लूड्स नाथ लिटरेचर सच एज द सॉन्ग्स ऑफ मैनामती एंड गोपी चंद्र, स्टोरीज कंसर्निंग द वर्शिप ऑफ धर्मा ठाकुर, एंड फेरी टेल्स, फोक टेल्स एंड बैलेड्स विच वर संग इन द रीजन अराउंड बंगाल. नाउ मैनामती, गोपी चंद्र एंड धर्मा ठाकुर, द नाथ्स वर एक्सेटिक एसेटिक्स, दैट इज योगीज हु एंगेज इन अ वैरायटी ऑफ योगिक practices. The particular song which was often enacted described how Mainamati, a queen, encouraged her son Gopi Chandra to adopt the path of asceticism in the face of a variety of obstacles. Dharma Thakur is a popular regional deity wahan pe, often worshipped in the form of a stone or a piece of wood. Alright. The texts belonging to the first category are easier to date. Now, several manuscripts have been found indicating that they were composed between the late 15th and the mid 18th century. So, the text belonging to the first category of literature are easier to date. Because they again belong to your basically late 15th to mid 18th century. Ke beech mein. Those belonging to the second category jo hai, circulated orally, jo baki ka literature tha, theek hai, that circulated orally between group of people, that is folk tales, folk ballads and other things. And cannot be precisely dated. So as such, unki koi hum dating properly nahi kar sakte. They are particularly popular in Eastern Bengal, where the influence of Brahmins was relatively weak. So wo Eastern Bengal mein zyada popular the, jahan pe Brahmins ka influence as such kam tha. Now, next is your peers and temples. From the 16th century, people began to migrate in large numbers from the less fertile western Bengal to the forested and marshy areas of southeastern Bengal. As they moved eastwards, they cleared forest and brought the land under rice cultivation. Gradually, local communities of fisher folk and shifting cultivators, often tribals, merged with the new communities of peasants. intermingling of these communities that has happened. This coincided with the establishment of the Mughal control over Bengal with their capital in the heart of the eastern delta at Dhaka. Officials and functionaries received land and other often set up mosques that served as centers for religious transformation in these areas. Mughal control ho gaya Bengal pe, then officials and functionaries ko zameen mili gayi jisse unhone mosque set up kare, and then later on it served as a center for religious transformation of that particular areas. Now the early settlers sought some order and assurance in the unstable conditions of new settlements, but these were provided by community leaders jo us time pe wahan pe the, who also functioned as teachers and educators and were sometimes described with supernatural powers. People referred to them with affection as respect as peers. So again, peer ka ek word aaga, the one who was seen as a guru or a teacher, all right, and who probably had some supernatural powers and helped people in times of bad situations. This term, this peer is used for the term saints or Sufis and other religious personalities daring colonizers as and defied soldiers, various Hindu and Buddhist deities and even animistic spirits. The cult of peers became very popular and their shrines can be found everywhere in Bengal even today. Now Bengal also witnessed that is temple building spree. Temples after temples probably were being built, so that is temple building spree from the late 15th century, which culminated in the 19th century. The temples and other religious structures were often built by individuals or group who were becoming powerful to both demonstrate their power. First of all, temples are being to demonstrate their power and proclaim their deity. Probably it should be deity here, and proclaim their deity. Many of their modest brick and terracotta temples in Bengal were built with the support of several even low social groups also as well, such as Kolu, that is oil pressers, and the Kansari, bell metal workers. So even other people also contributed in building up of temples here. The coming of European trading companies created new economic opportunities there, and many families belonging to these social groups availed of these. As their social and economic position improved, they proclaimed their status through the construction of these temples. All right, ki apni power ko batane ke, as their economic and social status improved under the probably the British, when their new job opportunities came up for them. When local deities once worshipped in thatched huts in village gained the recognition of the Brahmins, their images began to be housed in temples. The temples began to copy the double roofed dochala or the four roofed chauchala structure of the thatched huts. So again, jo roof hoti hai ya structure of the temples of these different, that is double roofed ya fir four roofed ko copy karke unko use kara gaya. This led to the evolution of typical Bengali style in temple architecture. So a Bengali different style of architecture developed hua during this period. In the comparatively, that is more complex four roof structure, four triangular roofs placed on four walls move up to converge on a curved line or a point. Temples were usually built on a square platform. The interior was relatively kept plain, but the outer walls of many temples were finely decorated with paintings, ornamental tiles, or terracotta tablets were installed. In some temples, particularly in Vishnupur in the Bankura district of West Bengal, such decorations reached a high degree of excellence, which how they were portrayed. All right, temples, because again they are showing it as a symbol of their power as well as a symbol of their strength and the proclamation of their deity as being one of the important deities. Fish as food. Traditional food habits are generally based on locally available item of food. Now Bengal, because it is a riverine plain, all right, which produces plenty of rice and fish, okay, and understandably these two items figure prominently in the menu of even poor Bengalis. So fish and rice is a common food which is the staple diet probably for most of the Bengalis, even of the poor people there. Fishing has always been an important occupation, and Bengali literature also contains several references to fish. What is more, that is terracotta plaques on the walls of temples also, and viharas, that is Buddhist monasteries, depicts scenes of fish being dressed and taken to the market in baskets. So that is how the importance of fish is being established in Bengal. Brahmins were not allowed to eat non-vegetarian food, but the popularity of fish in the local diet made the Brahminical authorities relax this prohibition for the Bengal Brahmins. So even Bengali Brahmins do eat fish. Okay. Then, now the Brihad Dharma Purana, a 13th century Sanskrit text from Bengal, permitted the local Brahmins to eat certain varieties of fish which they could consume. Now, bowl singing is one of the best known and much appreciated type of folk music which is there in Bengal and dates back to 15th century, sung by a religious group called bowls, and the songs they are sang are known as bowl gaan. Now, key words are bard, which is a poet, doha is a couplet, heritage, that is inheritance, kissa, ek tale hoti hai ya kahani, miniature, small or tiny, secular, that is non-religious, translation, convert or change. Now, let us quickly recall the few points here. So, medieval period saw the emergence of several regional languages and associated literature at that time. The main regional languages and literature again grew in Hindi, Urdu, Assamese, Bengali, Odia, Punjabi, Gujarati, Marathi, Telugu and Tamil. So, all these were growing regionally in their respective regions. Apart from the architecture that flourished under the sultans, regional art also developed in eastern, western, central as well as southern India, each with a distinct style of its own. Painting again developed under Mughals in miniature form, which was used for illustrations. Later painting developed in regional centers like Mewar, Bundi, Bijapur and Kangra. So, different regions again where paintings had developed. Music also developed into new forms like Qawwali and Khayal, and new instruments like sitar were also invented. So, these are some of the things which helped in shape up the helped in shaping up the regional cultures in various parts of the country. That is, we are talking about first language and literature here. Alright, then we are talking about art and architecture, and then we are talking about paintings which were made, and then also music and dance forms which developed in these different regions and which have helped in making up of the regional cultures. Okay, so this brings us an end to the chapter. Thank you so much.